springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy.
May the peace of the Lord be with you.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Good morning. Our first lesson today is from Isaiah chapter 55, verses 6 through 9. Seek the Lord while you can find him. Call on him now while he is near. Let the wicked change their ways and banish the very thought of doing wrong. Let them turn to the Lord, that he will have mercy on them. Yes, turn to our God, for he will forgive generously. My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. The word of God, the word of life. Thanks be to God. Psalm 27, verses 1 through 9. It is a psalm of David. The Lord is my light and my salvation, so why should I be afraid? The Lord is my fortress, protecting me from danger, so why should I tremble? When evil people come to devour me, when my enemies and foes attack me, they will stumble and fall. Though a mighty army surrounds me, my heart will not be afraid. Even if I am attacked, I will remain confident. The one thing I ask the Lord, the thing I seek most, is to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, delighting in the Lord's perfections and meditating in his temple. For he will conceal me there when troubles come. He will hide me in his sanctuary. He will place me out of reach on a high rock. Then I will hold my head high above my enemies who surround me. At this sanctuary I will offer sacrifices with shouts of joy, singing and praising the Lord with music. Hear me as I pray, O Lord. Be merciful and answer me. My heart responds, Lord, I am coming. My heart has heard you say, come and talk with me, and do not turn your back on me. Do not reject your servant in anger. You have always been my helper. Don't leave me now. Don't abandon me, God of my salvation. Today's second lesson is from Philippians chapters 1, verses 12 through 14, and 19 through 30. And I want you to know, my dear brothers and sisters, that everything that has happened to me here has helped to spread the good news. For everyone here, including the whole palace guard, knows that I am in chains because of Christ. And because of my imprisonment, most of the believers here have gained confidence and boldly speaks God's message without fear. For I know that as you pray for me and the Spirit of Jesus Christ helps me, this will lead to my deliverance. For I fully expect and hope that I will never be ashamed and that I will continue to be bold for Christ as I have in the past. I will trust that my life will bring honor to Christ, whether I live or die. For me, living means living for Christ, and dying is even better. But if I live, I can do more fruitful work for Christ. So I really don't know which is better. I'm torn between two desires. I long to go and be with Christ, which would be far better for me. But for your sakes, it's better that I continue to live. Knowing this, I am convinced that I will remain alive so I can continue to help all of you grow and enjoy the experience the joy of your faith. And when I come to you again, you will have even more reason to take pride in Christ Jesus because of what he is doing through me. Above all, you must live as citizens of heaven, conducting yourselves in a manner worthy of the good news about Christ. Then, whether I come and see you again or only hear about you, I will know that you are standing together with one spirit and one purpose, fighting together for the faith, which is the good news. Don't be intimidated in any way by your enemies. This will be a sign to them that they are going to be destroyed, but that you are going to be saved, even by God himself. For you have been given not only the privilege of trusting in Christ, but also the privilege of suffering for him. We are all in the struggle together. You have seen my struggle in the past, and you know that I am still in the midst of it. The word of God, the word of life. Thanks be to God.
Conquered the grave. He is David's ruler. The gospel reading according to Matthew 20, 1 through 16. Glory to you, O Lord. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. And after agreeing with the workers for a standard wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When it was about 9 o'clock in the morning, he went out again and saw others standing around in the marketplace without work. And he said to them, "You go into the vineyard too, and I will give you whatever is right." So they went. When they went out again about noon and 3 o'clock that afternoon, he said the same thing. And about 5 o'clock that afternoon, he went out and found others standing around and said to them, "Why are you standing there all day without work?" They said to him, "Because no one hired us." And he said to them, "You go and work in the vineyard too." When it was evening, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the workers and give the pay starting with the last hired until the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each received a full day's pay. And when those hired first, they thought they would receive more. But each one also received the standard wage. When they received it, they began to complain against the landowner, saying, "These last fellows worked 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who bore the hardship and the burning heat of the day." And the landowner replied to one of them, "Friend, I am not treating you unfairly. Didn't you agree with me to work for the standard wage? Take what is yours and go. I was to give to this last man the same as I gave to you. Am I not permitted to do what I want with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" And so the last will be the first, and the first the last. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Again, we're covering Luther's small catechism of Martin Luther. This time we're going to cover the Ten Commandments. The first commandment, "You shall have no other gods." What is this and what does it mean? You are to love, fear, love, and trust God above all things. Now, before we go too far, that's the first commandment according to Martin Luther's small catechism. I want to say that Martin Luther said it the best when he said, "Teach what you're going to teach according to how you learned it." So according to how you learned the Ten Commandments, or learned the Lord's Prayer, or learned the Apostles' Creed, teach it that way to others so that you're familiar with it and familiar with what you're teaching. What I'm teaching today is what is in the small catechism, and I want to repeat that first commandment, and then we'll go on to the second, because not all the Ten Commandments are written the same. The first commandment, "You shall have no other gods." What is this? Or what does it mean? We are to fear, love, and trust God above all things. It also says, means we should have no engraven images or no things that we hold up as idols above God, and we have to be very careful of that. The second commandment is, "You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God." What does this mean, and what does it? Where does it come from? We are to fear and love God so that we do not curse, swear, practice magic, or deceive using God's name. Instead use that very name in every time of need to call on, pray to, praise, and give thanks to God. Let me go back to the one saying it says, or deceive using God's name. Many times people will quote scripture and in a way that sounds like they're very important and they know what they're doing, but oftentimes it's to deceive. When you are using the scriptures to deceive, you are using God's name in vain. This is where we come from, that same talk about using God's name in vain. It's just not using his word, his name as a swear word. The third commandment, remember the Sabbath and keep it holy. What is this and what does this mean? We are to fear and love God so that we do not despise preaching or God's word, but instead keep the word holy and gladly hear and learn it. Many times people will hear somebody preach and they'll say, oh, I thought that was a terrible sermon. Well, you know something, it may have just been the same, the sermon that the person sitting next to you needed. And to sit there and judge against something that somebody has preached is to not do God's word any good at all. And I want to move on, and I want to quote from Romans 14:5, because we talk about the Sabbath, and we want to say this: some judge one day to be better than the other, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, or eat in the honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God. Whatever day, because Christ said, I am the Sabbath, whatever day you decide that you have that is free for the whole day to worship God, use that day and make it holy for you and God. The fourth commandment, honor your father and your mother. What is this? What does this mean? We are to fear and love God so that we neither despise nor anger our parents or others in authority, but instead honor, serve, obey, love, and respect them. It's not just about honoring your parents when you're younger, but it's also when they are older. It talks about helping them through their retirement years and stuff like that. Other people in authority would be people who are teachers of the Bible, people who are pastors, to honor them and respect them and love them too. The fifth commandment, you shall not murder. What is this and what does it mean? We are to fear and love God so that we neither endanger nor harm the lives of our neighbors, nor instead help and support them in all of their life's needs. Now, in a couple of Bibles, you'll hear this said as being, thou shalt not kill. But they wasn't really translated the way it should be, the way it was originally written in Hebrew. Because in Hebrew it actually reads, thou shalt not kill without just cause. Without just cause, if you kill somebody, that becomes murder. The sixth commandment is, you shall not commit adultery. What is this and what does this mean? You are to fear and love God so that we lead pure and decent lives in word and deed, and each of us loves, honors his or her spouse. So important, because God is the author of marriage too. The seventh commandment, you shall not steal. What is this and what does this mean? You are to fear and love God so that we neither take our neighbor's money or property, nor acquire them by using shoddy merchandise or crooked deals, but instead help them to improve and protect their property and income. The eighth commandment, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. What is this and what does this mean? We are to fear and love God so that we do not tell lies about our neighbors, betray or slander them, or destroy their reputation. Instead, we are to come to their defense, speak well of them, and interpret everything they do in the best possible light. The ninth commandment, you shall not covet your neighbor's house. What is this and what does this mean? We are to fear and love God so that we do not try to trick our neighbors out of their inheritance or property, or try to get it for ourselves by claiming to have legal right to it and the like, but instead be of help and service to them in keeping what is theirs. The tenth commandment, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife or male or female servant or ox or donkey or whatever belongs to your neighbor. What is this and what does this mean? You are to fear and love God so that we do not entice, force, or steal away from our neighbors, their spouses, household workers, or livestock, but instead urge them to stay and fulfill their responsibilities to our neighbors. What then does God say about all these commandments? God says the following, I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquities of the parents to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generations for those who love me and keep my commandments. What is this and what does this mean? God threatens to punish all who break these commandments. Therefore, we are to fear his wrath and not disobey these commandments. However, God promises grace and every good thing to all those who keep these commandments. Therefore, we also are to love and trust him and gladly act according to his commandments. This is God's word for today. Praise be to God.
A scornful wonder, men see her sore oppressed. Though foes would rend asunder the rock where she doth rest, yet saints their faith are keeping. Their cry goes on.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. God, the healer of all, bring comfort to the fearful and grieving, friendship to the forgotten, strength to the weak, and wholeness to those who are ill or in pain. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen.
Okay. So, ready? Who is Jesus?
Jesus is the Savior, the one who forgave us, the one who died for our sins.
God, the Lord.
He is our Christ, our Lord. He takes away our sins to help save us.
And what does Jesus look like?
I have no idea.
He had a big beard and long hair, and it looked like he was wearing a light brownish robey thing.
No one really knows what Jesus looks like because he never allowed himself to be photographed or drawn.
That was a really mysterious question.
Who were his disciples?
His disciples, they're easy to remember, mostly John, Peter, and Judas, I think.
Judas, Mark, Luke, John, Philip, Judas. I know one's like, I think one, Judas?
What did Jesus teach?
He taught about God.
And
I think so.
A care for us?
I think he taught how to be kind to other people.
God makes our earth. God is good to us.
Be nice to your parents.
What kind of miracles did Jesus do?
He made a man who's blind see, and he made a man who's disabled in the legs walk.
Jesus made one of his disciples walk on water.
Save people while they're sick.
He multiplied food.
And what would be a cool miracle for Jesus to do today?
Make my grandpa alive.
Give us more water because we're in drought.
We know. Shrink the earth.
Shrink the earth?
Make the earth go bigger!
He could fly around with zebra striped wings. That'd be awesome. Make pancakes rain from the sky.
Why did some people not like Jesus?
Because
they were jealous of him.
Yeah, jealous.
Some of the Jewish worship leaders didn't like him because they used to be the top dogs. And then Jesus came around doing all those miracles. They were like, what are you doing? Stealing our thunder.
He was doing stuff that was against the law.
Because people get to make their own decisions for if they want to follow him or not.
Because they were mean.
They were jealous.
And they didn't like what the other people loved about God.
What did those people do to Jesus?
Sacrifice him? Killed him.
Where did they kill him?
On the cross.
They hung him up on the cross.
Did he kill him?
I remember they crucified him and killed him.
But what happened on Sunday morning?
Sunday morning, he rose from the tomb. Well, technically on Sunday morning, they rolled away the tomb and nothing was there.
He came back alive.
He rose again. And there's an angel sitting there saying, Jesus is gone, he's alive. And sometime later, Jesus was walking around just like, hey, I'm not dead. And honestly, if it was me that was watching that in modern times, I'd be kind of freaked out. Like, didn't we just crucify him? It would be a great zombie movie. But
so how do we follow Jesus today?
You can like read the Bible and you can like pray.
Read his words in the Bible.
We follow Jesus today by praising his name, reading the Bible, going to church, and still celebrating the Sabbath.
Follow him.
How do we follow him?
Just walk, 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 walk.
No, listen to him.